Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday morning in the old cookbook show. Today, we're going to do a recipe out of this cookbook, the Mississippi Cookbook of New Southern Recipes. This is from 1922. And we're going to do a recipe out of this book for something called mock cherry pie. Now, it uses cranberries instead of cherries. And I kind of get this. Cranberries come into season at the opposite side of when cherries are in season. Cherries are an early spring, cranberries are late fall. I see it in this Mississippi cookbook. And I thought, oh, how does that become a recipe from Mississippi? So I go through a bunch of my other cookbooks to try to figure out, you know, what is Mississippi about it? And there's nothing Mississippi about it. Absolutely nothing Mississippi about it. Let's start out with the filling. First in is some sugar. I think first in is some sugar. I don't know. There's no real directions. Some flour. And I'm going to mix the sugar and flour together just a little bit. Some butter. Get that in. And some water. And I'm going to put in a little bit of vanilla as well. Now, having a fairly good collection of cookbooks, I have a lot of books at my disposal that I can look through. And so this cookbook from Indiana, for example, has two mock cherry pie recipes. And so I did a little bit of research a little bit farther, looked through some of my other books, and found more recipes for mock cherry pie. And the interesting thing to me is that they're all essentially the same. The proportions of raisins and cranberries might be a little bit different in each of the recipes, but the bulk of the recipe is exactly the same. And some of the recipes might add a little bit of extra detail of how to make the pie. And so this is not uncommon, not uncommon at all. And when I look through these cookbooks to sort of find the lineage of a recipe, what I'll often see is that they show up in clusters across the United States and Canada at about the same time, and sometimes with exactly the same spelling mistakes. And so when I look at all of the cookbooks, I can trace it back a little bit. In this instance, I was having a bit of difficulty tracing it back, but sometimes I can trace them back to a sort of a starting year, and then I'll look at newspapers across Canada and the United States. And what happens all the time is that I will start to see that a recipe shows up in syndication in every newspaper across the United States and Canada over, say, a two-month period. And then the next year, that recipe starts showing up in the community cookbooks. So someone sees a recipe in the newspaper, they love the recipe in the newspaper, they clip it out, they stick it onto their cupboard, and then the next year when their church is getting together to make a cookbook, they submit that recipe. Sometimes with the spelling mistake that's from the newspaper. And sometimes that spelling mistake turns up in the title of the recipe, and it changes the title of the recipe, and then, you know, here we are 100 years later or 200 years later wondering, why is the recipe called X? It's simply a spelling mistake that's happened along the way somewhere. So I think, judging by, you know, the use of cranberries, this is probably a recipe that originates in a far north, not far north, but a much farther northern area than Mississippi, probably in New England. Now, doesn't tell me much more than a list of ingredients and bake between two crusts. So, I wasn't sure which size pie plate to use, knowing that this is from pre-World War II, pie plates were usually smaller, so I've got a smaller pie tin. Actually, I used a tin, not a plate. So I'm going to set that aside. I'm going to set the filling aside, and we will roll out the top crust. So a little bit of flour on the bench. Down our pie dough, and we'll just roll that out. This recipe also comes from a very long lineage of recipes that are called mock something. And sometimes that mock comes from adversity. A certain ingredient was too expensive, but you still wanted to feel like you were eating it. So you would find a way around that almost worked. This almost works, and I don't know that it's from adversity, but it's really from maybe a scarcity at a certain time of the year. You still wanted to taste like you were eating a cherry pie, but you couldn't get the cherries. You know, and I've seen recipes for mock squirrel. I've seen recipes for mock brains. And I don't know about those recipes. I haven't tried them because I don't really feel like I am missing out on eating brains. We've tried brains. We have a brain recipe on our channel, so take a look for that. Now, I'm going to pour these into the pie plate. Looks like I have chosen the correct size pie plate. I'm going to go around the edge with an egg wash, which is just egg and water mixed up. That'll help the top crust stick. And we'll get that top crust on. And pinch it together. Okay, trim the pastry off from around the edge. And I'm just gonna cut a few slits in the top for steam to escape. You could do this much more artfully than I am doing and cut in some shapes. Now, it just says bake between two crusts. So I've got the oven preheated to 350 degrees. I have a baking sheet inside the oven in case this bubbles over, because I think it might. And I'm gonna stick that in and pretty much just until the crust is nice and golden. And then I'll just keep a close eye on it and we'll figure out how long it's gonna take.
Pretty good, Glen. Hey, friends.
Cherry pie.
Cherry pie. Okay. I like cherry pie. One of my favorites as a child. Always what I asked for my birthday. That looks like raisin, though.
There are raisins.
There are raisins in my cherry pie? What?
Cherry pie with raisins.
I'm now suspicious. Should I be suspicious?
Oh, why would you be suspicious?
Because those aren't cherries. I don't... What are those?
Can't get it on my fork.
I was gonna take the filling.
That's crazy.
How much it actually kind of almost tastes like cherry pie?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of weird.
Yeah. So it's not cherry.
No, it's clearly mock, not. Because
it's mock
they
cherry.
Don't look like cherries.
No.
What are they though?
Cranberries.
Oh, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay. As a shape, it's not the flavor. I guess that's what adds the tartness.
It has that tart, but there is a cherry note there, probably coming from the raisins. The layer of raisins in there gives it away that it's not a cherry pie, because you don't expect raisins. But overall, the flavor is really good. Now, I would throw that down on the table at Thanksgiving, and be completely open and honest and just say, it's a cranberry pie.
Yeah.
You know?
Sorry, I laugh, because you know,
I hate cranberries.
It's funny for two reasons. One, you don't like cranberries.
No.
We never have them because you don't like them.
No.
I love them. And two, I know that people give us strange looks when we say we brought a squash pie, when it's actually like a pumpkin pie or a butternut pie, butternut squash or whatever. It's essentially what people would call pumpkin pie.
Pumpkin pie. But I'm so...
That's actually quite a good pie.
And I have to be straight up honest. If someone dropped that down and said, oh, it's a cranberry pie, I would pass.
I know you would.
I would pass. But now that I've had it, it's kind of like, oh, that's a really good pie. I like that.
It's kind of, what I like about it, I'm not a big fan of raisin pie because I find it too sweet and too rich. So the cranberries kind of cut that.
Yeah, the tartness of the cranberry cuts that.
Okay, clearly I'm going to just keep eating it.
Okay, so mock cherry pie. Stop mocking it. It's really good.
That's
Thanks awful. For stopping by. See you again soon.